Shalom, dear friends, wonderful to be with you today. You know, we are going to speak about a city who has 70 names. 70 names, isn't it amazing? This is Jerusalem. She's called Zion, Ariel, the city of the great king, and many more. And today we have Fleur, who is the deputy mayor of Jerusalem, Fleur Hassan-Nahoum. Thank you so much for coming with us.
Thank you for inviting me, Natalie.
I know, it's great. We are going to have a great program speaking about Jerusalem, this beautiful capital.
My favorite subject.
Good, me too. So Fleur was born in Gibraltar, and she went to England. She's done some studies over there. She was a barrister in London. Then you made Aliyah in 2001. This is wonderful. So we have you now with us, and you discover your beautiful country. Did you travel before a bit in Israel?
I came to Israel the first time when I was 14 years old for my cousin's wedding, and I fell in love with the country. And then I came back when I was 16 on like a youth tour group with Bnei Akiva, and that's when I realized that I was going to live here.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. And so you came in 2001. And after you set up also, now you work first of all with some a non-profit organization who's looking after children, abused children who are coming from the former
Soviet Union.
That's it. And then in 2011, you started your own business.
That's right.
And then you went in May 2016, you came to be a city councillor in the city of Jerusalem.
That's right.
Then In 2017, in February, you became the leader of the opposition.
That's right.
Very interesting. And then again in November 2018, you were appointed deputy mayor, especially speaking also with a foreign relationship, which is very interesting.
That's what I do. That's foreign it. Relations and tourism.
And
that's
tourism.
My portfolio.
Okay. So I have first question. Jerusalem is the city of the great king, is a beautiful capital. And now, how did you get involved in politics and specifically in relation, in foreign relationship? And why was your choice?
Why did I decide? I think you always have to be a little bit mad or to be a politician or to have seen it at home. And I was very, very privileged to have been raised by a wonderful statesman and politician who was my father. He was the chief minister of Gibraltar, which is like the prime minister of Gibraltar. So I was born into it. My father was already the prime minister when I was born. So that's what I saw in my house. But more than everything, I just saw a man who was completely, completely dedicated to public service, who helped everybody that came to him, allies and enemies alike. And so I had very high standards by what I felt a public servant was. I thought about politics, but I didn't kind of plan out my career to be a politician. But then an opportunity presented itself. And I always think that when God opens a door, then you walk through it. Mm-hmm. And because of my background, I felt this is the moment that I can come and start serving my city.
Oh, this is wonderful. Now, Jerusalem is a city of truth, is a city of the great king. And so what does your job entail? And there is a lot of responsibility.
That's right. So when the mayor, Moshe Leon, won and he was building his coalition, he asked me, what do you want? And I said, I want foreign relations for a number of reasons. Jerusalem is an international city. It's not just our city. It's a city that is home to all religions. It's a city that is of international standing. And I felt that because I wasn't born here and because I speak several languages and understand the different mentalities around the world, that I was the person that could be the face of Jerusalem to bring into Jerusalem new partnerships, trade, collaboration, diplomatic relations. And so this is what I spend my day doing, and I really love it. And I feel that I'm privileged to be in the position that I'm a woman in modern Jerusalem, in the capital of the state, of our people, of our country, and I get to represent this city, this wonderful city, historical city, to the world.
This is wonderful. And again, you see, like, there is so many prophecies, Isaiah 2, that the nations will come. So obviously you can see that. And so how do you facilitate Jerusalem about all these foreign relations?
So we do it in a number of ways. We have probably three different ways that I represent Jerusalem. So first of all, I represent Jerusalem on a diplomatic level. This week, for example, we had the new president of Guatemala. Guatemala is a very important ally to Jerusalem because Guatemala decided after the United States that they were going to move their embassy to the city. And they were the first, actually, first country to move the embassy to the city, second country to declare it, first country to move it.
And so I remember seeing on the wall of Jerusalem, they've done something to say thank you very much.
So this is something that I facilitated, for example.
Very good.
So this is my job. My job is to facilitate diplomatic ties, to be here for them, holding their hands when they move their embassies, trade offices, trade ties, to introduce Israeli companies to different countries, to exchange know-how, to represent Jerusalem in different international committees, European committees. So it's part of my work. The other part of my work is the relations with the Christian world, for example. The Christians today are our best friends, and we do a lot of faith-based diplomacy with the Christian world. So I'm always on hand to speak to them. Because I'm a fluent Spanish speaker, a lot of our ties are in South America, Central America, so I'm very privileged to be able to speak to them in their mother tongue about Jerusalem. And so all these relationships and all these ties, which are deeply important to the country and deeply important to our city, is something that I have the privilege to be able to do on a day-to-day.
And Jerusalem is recognized now by more and more nations to be the capital of Jerusalem.
Yes.
So why do you think it's important for Jerusalem itself to have its own foreign relations?
That's a great question. Well, first of all, we are the capital city of the State of Israel. We're also the capital city of the Jewish world. And we're an international city. We're an ancient city built by King David. And so therefore, Jerusalem has its own brand. It's part of Israel, of course. It's the center, heart, and the beating soul. But on top of that, Jerusalem has its own brand, and therefore should have its own brand ambassadors. Mm-hmm. And I consider myself one of those.
This is interesting. Now, you know, like I was discovering that Jerusalem has 70 names.
Yes.
And so when I think we speak also about 70 nations, so I wonder if it's also for everybody to feel good and at home. I heard so many people say, oh, when I arrive here in Israel, I feel at home. What do you think about that?
I believe that Jerusalem in its very DNA is not just a place with 70 names, but it's the reason why King David built the capital and the heart and soul of the Jewish people and the Jewish monarchy then in Jerusalem was because it was never belonged to one tribe. Jerusalem was a place that physically, geographically, was a meeting place for different tribes. And so in our very DNA is diversity. And with that diversity comes the embracing of all these different nations. I'll tell you a little secret. My four kids all have names connected to the names of Jerusalem or Jerusalem. Yes, that was one thing that when I started having kids, it was very important to me that part of their identity should be that they are Jerusalemites, mm-hmm. not just Israelis.
So it's quite amazing that now you are here, you are like the deputy mayor, and so you are the core really of what's happening in Israel.
It's beautiful. There's a lot of people who do fantastic work in the city, and I happen to have the privilege of being one of them.
Mm-hmm. I follow you now on Facebook, and I'm really pleased because I can, you know, it's
thank
like you can feel the dynamic, you know, the action that you are doing and all of that. So it's wonderful. Now, what I was looking, just because I was on your Facebook and I saw the picture that you put of a policeman who was bringing an old lady Arab to her place of prayer.
Yes.
And this is Jerusalem too.
This is a big part of Jerusalem. What people don't understand, not just around the world, but also in our own country, is that the solution to our conflict, the laboratory for what coexistence will look like is here in Jerusalem, because our demographic makeup is completely different to anywhere else in the country. We have 37% Arabs, 25% ultra-Orthodox Jews, 21% secular, 20-something percent people in the middle, people who are religious or traditional. That means that we have everything here. We have the biggest convergence of the different, sometimes conflicting populations, and therefore the solution can only come from Jerusalem. Mitzion titzeh Torah, from Zion, Torah will come out. But the Torah that is coming out is different types of Torah. It's not the traditional Torah of our scriptures, but it's also innovation. It's also building a shared society. It's social innovation. It's everything new and innovative that's coming out of the state of Israel is mainly coming out of Jerusalem. You know, even when we look at the Startup Nation, 50% of the value of the Startup Nation was created by Jerusalemites, some who stayed, but some who left. But it's created by that very special environment that we have in the city for diversity, which is tied into innovation. And it expresses itself in many different ways.
It's just amazing. It's just amazing. I love this country. And I love Jerusalem because, Jerusalem is really
unique. I couldn't
imagine
living anywhere else.
Now, how do you use your position to aid and promote also women? Because you are women, and I know you are doing specific things for women.
Absolutely. Look, first of all, I think that I like to tell the message that people forgot, and that is that alongside the fathers of Zionism that we all look up to, there's some incredible mothers of Zionism that people forget about. The women who created the first hospitals in the country, the women who created the social welfare infrastructure in the country, the health infrastructure in the country, the early childhood infrastructure in the country, these were all women. These were all women leaders who were there creating the Zionist dream with our Zionist fathers.
Could you give us some example? Like I think Emuna, but some
Emuna, Witzo, Hadassah. You know, we have Rebecca Seif, you know, women like that, Hannah Zenish. These are women who looked at the reality and said, you know, it's all very well to create diplomatic ties, to create the political the political state of Israel, but people are dying. Mm. Children are dying of malnutrition. There are no hospitals. What good is it to have a country if you don't have people who are healthy and are functioning? That's one of the things they did. The other thing they did is that they brought to the forefront of the conversation at the time, of the discourse at the time, that you can't build a new country with half the workforce. Women have to be part of the workforce. And so organizations like that trained women to become farmers. This is really something revolutionary at the beginning of the century, last century. And so they created a situation where women and men were equal in the workforce. I'm not saying there's a lot to do here still, but the state of Israel was created on a premise of equality. Very few states can boast that they were created on a premise of equality, of gender equality, but we can. Now, there's still a lot to do, and I fight for inequalities every single day. I fight to fix those inequalities, but let's not forget that our roots are based on gender equality. So the first thing I do is spread that message. The second thing I do is look where there are gaps in society today. And we see gaps everywhere, but mainly we see a lack of enough political representation of women in the highest decision-making bodies. Only
In the city?
In the city or? And in the country. Okay. So in the country, we've gone down in the last Knesset from 30%, 29-30% to 25%. But in local politics, we've gone up from 13% to 19%. So the 5% we lost in national politics, we gained in local politics, but it's still not good enough. I believe that we live in an unbalanced world because 50% of women are not represented in decision-making bodies. So I will not rest until decision-making has been made by 50% of women. Otherwise, we will remain in an unbalanced world. And so that has different expression in different communities. With Arab women in East Jerusalem, we're trying to make sure that they're empowered to go out to work, create their own businesses. With ultra-Orthodox women, they already work, but we're trying to upgrade their salaries and their workplaces so that they do real high-powered work. And in schools, and in the public space, I'm trying to create better image for women to make sure that the image of the woman is not just erased, but is equal to men. And that's
very
what we
good.
Do.
Wonderful. I can see that there is some fire there.
Oh, there's a lot of fire. They have to like break, you know.
Yeah. And I guess, is it easy in the city council?
That's a good question. 50% of the city council of Jerusalem is ultra-Orthodox men who have no women in their parties. One of the things that I help my my feminist sisters in the ultra-Orthodox community, and there are many, is to try and reach the point where there is ultra-Orthodox women's representation in ultra-Orthodox parties. It's not good enough for them to be in a regular party. They want to be in ultra-Orthodox parties, and they don't allow that. So, you know, these are the things that we fight for. In city council, I work very closely with the ultra-Orthodox, the way that I work with everybody. There are things that we agree on, the things that we disagree on. We respect each other, but I will continue fighting, and they know that.
Very good, yeah, because obviously you have all type of Jews. You have the Arabs, you have the Christians.
Everything. So it's like we're the most diverse city in the country. And even amongst the Jews, the biggest immigration absorption that goes on in the country is in Jerusalem, followed closely by Tel Aviv. Sometimes, some years they beat us, some years we beat them. But we basically absorb the highest amount of immigrants. But we have immigrants from everywhere in the world. Mm-hmm. So not only do we have Jews and Arabs and Christians, we also have Jewish immigrants from 100 countries around the world, languages that you hear in the city, and different culture that they bring with them. So that's, you know, I believe that a melting pot that we are is very valuable to be able to keep your identity, but also to be able to be part of the higher cause that is Jerusalem.
Wonderful. We were speaking a bit about the high tech, and we've done some program also with people with startups, and it's like amazing to see what's happening and the way of people of thinking, and it's like is going like more, and I mean, it's like we can see developing, and is there is a power, there is something going on. And Jerusalem is also doing things about that. Could you tell us a bit about
yes.
the high
tech? So up until about 7 years ago, high tech was something that you didn't see too much of in Jerusalem, which was a real shame because the best higher education institutions in the country are in Jerusalem. Hebrew University, Bezalel Arts School, the different engineering colleges, Azrieli, Hadassah College, Machon Lev. We really do have top-tier academic institutions in the city. But somehow, they weren't connected to any type of industry. And the big revolution that we've had in the last 7 years, which is really driving forward our economy, is the marriage of academia and industry, so that industry can really take the value from the inventions and the amazing innovation and research that's coming out of our academic institutions. And that's really given a great push. And the reason why it's important is because we need to keep our young people in the city, our young, diverse populations in the city. It's no good if we end up in a city with only a certain type of people, with only ultra-Orthodox, with only Arabs, with only... We need everybody here. And therefore, bringing high tech, bringing high quality jobs to the city is a huge part of our agenda. Mm-hmm. And doing the bridge between academia and industry has been a big part of the strategy to push forward the technological ecosystem in the city. And we've gone 3 times more startups than we had, 4 times more investment that we had in the city, and the future is bright. We have fantastic human capital here, and the idea is that we want to leverage and we want to take our human capital to its greatest potential for the good of everybody and the city.
Yeah, that's wonderful. So tell us also about the population. How much population? And as you say, you want the people to stay, so we need to have more houses.
That's a good question. Now, one of the biggest challenges in our city is that housing is very expensive for younger people. And that comes as a function of, you know, simple economics. We don't build enough. There's not enough supply, and therefore the demand drives up the prices. So the mayor, Mayor Leon, is very much into the idea that he wants to build more housing so that younger people can stay in the city, can afford to stay in the city. And he's pushing this very, very strongly. This year, for example, the first year of his mayorship, the number of housing approvals, permits given, has doubled. Wonderful. And so we hope that this is just going to go up and up, and then young people won't be pushed out of the city because they can't afford it.
Mm-hmm. Very good, because I knew that this is one of the big problem. How many inhabitants now in Jerusalem?
Oh, so we have over 920,000 inhabitants in the city.
Mm-hmm. And the greatest Jerusalem, is it about 1 million?
The greater Jerusalem, like places like, you mean Mevaseret and the Gush?
Mm-hmm.
Probably 1.5 million.
One and a half.
I probably, ooh, but I'm not 100% sure of the number, okay. But that's what okay. I but that's what I believe is the number, yes. And we can look at Jerusalem as a metropolis. In many things that we do in Jerusalem now, we look at the metropolis of Jerusalem. We look at all the surrounding communities, also in Judea and Samaria, and also in the outskirts of Jerusalem. And we look at transport planning, for example, and economic planning as a metropolis. Mm-hmm. We look at that and we take that into account, and the planning authorities also do.
Wonderful, because we can see there is the train now, there is the rakevet, the tram.
These are all game changers for the city. All game changers for the city. And look, ultimately, it doesn't bother me that people live in Beit Shemesh and work in Jerusalem, but I need people, good quality people, diverse people, working and making Jerusalem the place that they're at most of the day. Mm. If you want to come and sleep in Mevaseret, I'm not going to say no.
Wonderful. Thank you for all this information. This is wonderful. Now, again, we go back. Jerusalem is the eternal city. It's written. So it's like amazing to think about that. And you personally, in 5, 10, 20 years, what can you see with Jerusalem? What's happening?
What will happen in Jerusalem? Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, in the next 10 years, there's going to be such extensive infrastructural development that the city will completely change. We're going to have three new light rail lines, the heavy train from Tel Aviv, which will be 25 minutes, which is a real game changer. We're going to have extensive building across the city. We're still going to keep the integrity of the history and the character of our city, because we have planning policy that you don't build in certain areas, but you can build in other areas, depending on its historical value. We're going to be a city thriving with business, financial, technological services. And I believe we're going to see a city with much more integration of ultra-Orthodox and Arabs into the mainstream economy, and I hope the innovation economy, because we're all in the same boat. And if there's a hole on one side of the boat, the ship is still going down. And I believe that we have to empower the minorities in our city, because our prosperity is tied into their prosperity. And this is something that I do on a day-to-day. And I believe Jerusalem will be an even more cosmopolitan city and a, please God, much wealthier city.
Mm, wonderful. Now, what's happening with the Arab people? Because I knew that it was difficult for them to say, we want to be part
exactly.
of the city.
Exactly. They're in a bit of a difficult situation, because on the one hand, they're pressurized by the Palestinian Authority and Hamas and all these other groups not to normalize ties with Jerusalem, with the authorities in Jerusalem. On the other hand, they understand that their salvation is not coming from the Palestinian Authority and Hamas. And they understand that their future is much more tied in with us than it is, unfortunately for them, with them. And therefore, what we are seeing is much more normalizing of ties between East Jerusalem and West Jerusalem. We see many more Arab students in our universities and our colleges. And please God, we will see many more Arab young people integrated into the technological ecosystem of the city.
And for the schools, are they like separated?
That's a great question. All the schools in Jerusalem are separate. We have different systems. We have the ultra-Orthodox school system. We have the modern Zionist religious school system, where my children are. We have the secular school system. And we also have the Arab school system. But even the Arab school system is also divided between municipality schools and non-municipality schools. What we're trying to do at the moment is to try and encourage Arab schools to take a curriculum that does two things that they don't do today. One is they don't really teach Hebrew. And I think that if they want to have economic prosperity, Hebrew is pretty basic. But because their Arab leaders have been anti-normalization, Hebrew is something that hasn't been taught. And what we find from East Jerusalem is a real thirst for Hebrew, because they understand that the good jobs and that, you know, good places in higher education institutions only come with the language. And so this is something that we're really trying to focus on, trying to bring Hebrew language into Arab schools and trying to give them a curriculum that helps them advance in Israel. It is not our intention to give them a Zionistic curriculum. It is our intention to give them a curriculum of opportunity. And this is something they don't have today.
Mm. So for you, where is the future for Jerusalem?
Oh, for me particularly? Mm-hmm. Like I say, I want to see my city grow and thrive. I want to see all the countries around the world finally recognize that we have the right to choose our own capital city, like every country, move their embassies. I envision, and I'm working towards building an embassy district around the American embassy, wherever that will be, and they're still undecided, and really put Jerusalem on the map as one of the main international cities of the world where you can get business done, where you can come and be inspired, and where you can come and learn how and what a shared society looks like.
Can you see, like, Jerusalem was like a sleeping dormant beauty, and she's been sleeping for two millennia, and now she's rising up. She's been kissed by her people. The people are coming back here. And she's getting so beautiful. Fleur, again, thank you for coming, because it's wonderful to see what's happening here in Jerusalem.
It's very exciting.
And
I'd like to invite all our Christian friends around the world to come and visit, because this is not just a place of the book. This is not just a place where you can live the Bible, but it's also just a fun holiday to bring your kids, to enjoy everything we have to offer, to eat well, to have good culture. It's just a great place to come to learn, but also to enjoy.
So one final word from you, Fleur.
So, you know, Jerusalem is a place of convergence. It's where heaven and earth meet. It's where East and West meet. It's where old and new meet. And so that very special atmosphere is something that I want everybody to be able to come experience and plug into. As we look at our past with pride, but we also look at a very exciting future.
Friends, I hope that you enjoyed this interview with Fleur Hassan-Nahoum. She's the deputy mayor of Jerusalem, and this is to give you a little taste of Jerusalem. Please come here and you will see, you will want to come and come and come again. This is what happened to so many people. Fleur, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Natalie.
I know, thank you. And from Fleur and from me, bye, and see you later.